It's sad that it's all gone down. You know, all we can do is come together and persevere. You know, for those people who are up north and, you know, surviving, you know, keep doing what you're doing. Keep hope alive. Keep your head up. You know, the worst part about it is they're talking about another one coming right behind it. So it's very important that we make sure that we take care of ourselves, our family. And, you know, the biggest thing to do is stay together, be together, and together we will get through this.
April?
Yeah, it is definitely a humbling experience and humbling pictures. The video, there was a lady on TV, I can't recall which morning show it was, but she was saying 2 years ago her house caught on fire and she lost everything. Now it's flooded out and she's lost everything again. And she was crying, said she's trying to figure out what she did in life, that she just feels like, you know, God is like trying to get her back or something. And it's very, very humbling because we take for granted, you know, that we're going to walk home and turn the lights on and everything is going to come cut on, or, you know, we're on our way home from work and our home is just going to be there, you know.
DJ, we got DJ Renee Melendez joining us on the live line. Renee, what's going on, girl?
What's going on, Marcus? How you doing?
Appreciate it. You're in Jersey City. You on the ground there. What's going on? What's your thoughts?
I live in North Plainfield, but I was in Jersey City today. And there are certain sections in the Greenville area, downtown, Journal Square, the Heights, and we'll even throw Bayonne in there, where certain areas have power and certain areas are still without power. There are people on the west side of Jersey City, close to Mallory Avenue, close to 440, that are still without power. And, you know, it's very scattered right now. I happen to be real lucky. My power came back on Wednesday. And so at least, you know, I wasn't in the dark. But it's a very eerie situation with the lights being out. I was just down there in August, and I visited with you guys. And being down there, you know, you're used to when you're on these country roads and stuff, you're used to not seeing light. But when you're in a city and you walk outside and you're seeing street lights and stuff, to actually come outside and to drive down the road, and I was on Route 22 going eastbound, to only see just the distance of my headlights in front of me, right, and to look at my rearview mirrors and not see anything but pitch blackness behind me.
Right, right.
It was something like, it's like out the Twilight Zone.
Let me ask you this, Renee. You and I grew up on the same street in Jersey City. What we looking like in that area? We don't have to call them out. We don't have to call them out, but we grew up on the same street.
Mm-hmm.
Is our street back on?
As
far as I know, they are. Mom and Pop said that they okay, but you mentioned that certain areas are on and certain areas aren't.
Yeah, that area didn't get power until Saturday.
Okay, okay. Couple of things. I'm actually glad that you called. A couple of quick things I'm gonna throw at you. So far, when I went and did some homework this morning, we'd lost 106 people who lost their lives directly related to the storm. You still have a lot of people that don't have power. You had Newark, New Jersey Mayor Cory Booker tweeting for folks to come and kick it with him at his crib. And I actually saw someone who tweeted behind Cory Booker that person actually took him up and was actually at his crib charging up her cell phone, and he was cooking for the people who lived in his general area. You also had the governor, Chris Christie, which we're going to talk a little bit about him, praising the president of the United States, Barack Obama, on his response to the storm, Sandy. Whereas the former head of FEMA, Mike Brown, and former mayor of New York, Rudy Giuliani, both came out and criticized the president for his handling, both saying that he responded too quickly. You're in the area, you're on the ground. What's your thoughts on that? And then we're going to round table it with the crew.
Well, regarding Cory Booker is a really, really cool guy. He real down to earth, real approachable. So the fact that he's inviting people over to his crib to charge their phones and stuff, I'm not surprised by that. That's just the type of cat he is. In terms of Chris Christie, I want to read something to you. One of my friends posted this morning on Facebook. He said, Chris Christie once said Obama was like a man in the dark looking for the light switch But it's funny when the same dude whose back you just kicked in calls you when you're in the dark and asks, how can I help you? Christy now knows you can say what you want about a person, but when that person reaches out to you to show you some love, then it's you that has to step into the light. That's a pretty profound statement, because Chris Christie was the keynote speaker for the Republican National Convention. So the same person that you kicked in for months and talked so negatively about, soon as your state was in a complete devastation, that one individual picks up the phone and says, what can I give you to help? Is FEMA responding in the way that they should? Are you getting everything that you need? If not, call me back directly. Here's my number. That's a big statement. And I also think it was very big of Chris Christie to actually step up on, you know, and say the bipartisanship. You know, it's not about what party you're serving, but it's about working together to get things accomplished. That was big. It didn't really look good for Mitt Romney, because, you know, Romney donated stuff, but guess what? That's a tax write-off for him.
Well, here's the thing. I'm gonna jump in there and just kind of address a couple of the things that you said, Renee, and then we're going to round table it with the crew. I appreciate you calling us up. Thank you for your insight on the ground. We're going to keep in touch with you. Hopefully everything is back to normal, but please, please, please keep us abreast of what's going on in the area, because we want to know. We're raising money. We're trying to get people listening, you know, how Steppin' with Marcus J, to holler at us and holler at the Red Cross to send some money to the people who are affected. Not so much in the Jersey City area, because we mostly are dealing with power outages there, but a lot of people on the Jersey Shore, as well as in the Long Island, Brooklyn, Queens area of New York City, are majorly affected. So we appreciate your information. Thank you so much for calling us tonight. We got much love for you, girl.
All right, talk to you guys later. Take care.
All right, peace. I'm gonna just kind of throw my two cents on this real quick, and then we're gonna roundtable it with the room. As far as I'm gonna address kind of the things that Renee said. As far as Governor Christie is a Republican, but here's the thing. I guess because I'm not there, it's my home state. Because I'm not there, I know that generally people that I'm affiliated with are not very fond of him because of some of his brutish ways. He's brash. He's, you know, as being somewhat of a bully and things of that sort. But my impression of him all along has always been of a guy who says what he feels, who says what he's thinking, and is not necessarily controlled by the establishment. He happens to be a Republican. I'm an independent, so just because he's a Republican doesn't necessarily have him be adverse to me. It just means that, you know, he's a Republican. The fact that he reached out to the president, the president reached out to him, and they've got, you know, the media is kind of blowing it up, making it like a love fest. No, this is a governor who's being proactive about what's going on in his state, and he knows that the federal government has money that can assist him with what's going on in his state. So he's being proactive along with the proactive president to make sure that the residents of the state of New Jersey get what they need. Where the hell has Andrew Cuomo been, the governor of New York? Maybe he's doing something, but I haven't heard it. You had Chris Christie go on Fox News, and they asked him about Mitt Romney. He said, I don't give a damn what Mitt Romney is doing. I got people here that don't have no food. They don't have no lights. They don't have no power. I need to worry about them. Fox News tried to politicize it and ask him about Mitt Romney, where he was like, look, I ain't worrying about no Mitt Romney. I'm worrying about my peoples here. And that's the whole thing. And then you got this whole quote-unquote love affair with him and the president. No. You got a governor who's asking for help and a president who's able to give it. So you got Mitt Romney, who hasn't gone there, but I don't have a problem with him not going there because he can't do nothing. He's not the person in power. What's he going to go there for? I'll tell you what he did do, though. He purchased a whole bunch of supplies. Then he paid people to donate it to him to make it seem like he was benevolent. That's the Mitt Romney that we are seeing. So, you know, this whole thing about trying to politicize a storm where people are put out, APP, that I have a big problem with.
I agree 110%. One thing that I can say is that it's not because of the election tomorrow, and, you know, we're all on our, you know, political thing. It's not about, you know, they're great now. They're buddies now. They're about to go have a brew together. It's not like that. It's two men trying to do their job. And that's basically all it is. It's two men trying to do their job. It's Barack Obama's responsibility to offer help. It's the governor's job to find help. So, and in the end, they both want their job. They both want to be reelected. You know, call a spade, that's what it is. So, two men, they're doing their job. And in any type of disaster, whether it's a natural disaster or what have you, you're going to lay down the political mess. You should. I don't think Mitt Romney did, but you should lay down the political mess long enough to be human, to take care of everyone and make sure everything is taken care of. I would like everybody's opinion as far as how you think it will affect voting tomorrow with people who may not be able to get out or who still don't have power.
I don't really have an opinion on that, to be honest with you. I mean, I feel like that if Mitt Romney really wanted to do something, he would have. I mean, my thing is, you got stuff there that's being used or not being used and whatever. You want to do some? How about you buy out everything in all the Sam's Clubs and all the BJ's out there, and then you donate that, because there's stuff there. You don't have to transport from one place to another. The stuff is already there. I mean, the president is doing the job that he's supposed to do. He's supposed to call Christie, yo, what you need from me? Or Christie, hey, look, I need to reach out to the president. I need help. I mean, that's what they're supposed to do. As far as the whole politicizing everything, you know what? If people think this is a political move, then you think what you think. But the president has to be the president, and that's what he's supposed to be doing.
I'm impressed with the response New Jersey and New York has received from the government. It's not a lot of red tape. It seems that we're more prepared for this. Again, the hype is built up all along that it was going to get hit. Seeing some of the pictures, though, it is very devastating and amazing how the New Jersey boardwalk has been devastated.
It's gone. It's gone.
You see boats that weigh tons in the city streets. My biggest fear now is not so much for the health, well, the welfare of the people, but the health of the people, considering the water contamination, some of the rodents that are present in those areas, and whatever else can go on. I'm hoping that these people get something sooner than later. I'm glad for the Red Cross to be here, and please go out and try to donate if you can to them, such that we can provide further support to our sister states. It is very humbling, really it is. Being here in Richmond, we were hyped to get something very strong and power failing just like they did, but we were fortunate. We got a light downpour in most occasions, and some wind, but that was about it.
Here's what I want to do. I want to kind of talk a little bit about how some of these people have tried to politicize this. Mitt Romney, anybody know, I'm an independent who happens to lean left. I support President Obama. So a lot of the things that I say will come out as if I'm bashing Mitt Romney. I'm really not. All I'm saying is I'm analyzing what this dude does and what he says. That's it. Big rule. Mitt Romney said that the cleanup there was similar to the cleanup of his high school gym when they had some issues there when he was coming up. Cleaning up, you know, the area. It was like cleaning up his high school gym. Now, I mentioned a minute ago about how Mike Brown, who used to head FEMA, and former mayor of New York City, Rudolph Giuliani, both said that the president of the United States, Barack Hussein Obama, has had negative reaction to his response to what's going on with the storm. So, Big Rule, I'm going to start with you first. What's your thoughts on the right side trying to politicize what's going on with this storm? I know you said a minute ago that you didn't have an opinion on part of it, but I really want to know what you're feeling about this, because I'm feeling some kind of way about it, me personally. This is my home state here, you know what I mean? So I'm extra passionate about it. So when I saw Governor Christie and the President of the United States putting partisanship aside and working with the people of the state to try to put them back together, I was feeling pretty good about that until I heard these two dudes come out and say what they say, basically politicizing these people's plight. And the closest thing that we have had to this in recent years is Hurricane Katrina down in New Orleans, and we know how that worked out, Big Road.
I think the Mayor Giuliani and the other dude who used to run FEMA, they need to go ahead and just shut up. I mean, how do you sit here and basically bash the president for reacting too soon? What kind of dumbass is that? I mean, for me, that's just stupid. Politicizing, you know, Giuliani, that's why you didn't get reelected. That's why nobody wants you in the Senate, because you're stupid. I mean, it's that simple, you know. He was a mayor of New York, and now he's not. He ran for Senate, and he lost. I mean, it's just stupidity. It's just stupidity. Politicizing, whatever. The president is doing his job. So when he's doing his job, this is what he does. I mean, to me, it's just idiotic and stupid and all together. Let me see. The other question was, we're talking about those two. What was the other one? Do you remember the other one, April?
I don't.
I mean, I think it's being handled correctly. You know, you got to do what you got to do. And if you want to politicize something, when Katrina happened, who was president when Katrina happened?
Bush.
That's right. George Bush.
The whole point of it is the fact that anytime the president does something, no matter what he does, mm-hmm. the forces are going to have a negative response to it. Like, the dude could do nothing good. Like nothing good. Mm-hmm. Now, in defense, I remember being on that side, or the other side, I should say, when President Bush was the president. That's just kind of how it goes.
Yeah.
You know, but I suppose that depending on what side of the political aisle you fall on, the person that's against you or opposite to your natural inclination is likely to have negative response from you based upon what they do. But the only difference is when it was Katrina, they really did take forever.
They really did nothing.
They really did take forever. Right. You know, when it came down to the war, it really was that y'all lied, and a lot of us knew about it from the beginning.
Right.
We kind of knew that it was Al-Qaeda and Osama bin Laden. We kind of didn't think that it was, you know, Saddam Hussein in Iraq. So when we was kind of against George Bush, we had actual reasons that we could put our fingers on, whereas this time, you know, these dudes came out and was like first one-term president before he even moved in. So this is the reason why I bring up the whole politicizing, April. Mm-hmm. Like, really? Is it really anything that he does going to be negative? I mean, the guy was on the ground with these people mm-hmm. 2 days after the storm hit. Mm-hmm. And he was there hugging people and telling them everything was going to be all right. And the governor of that state went on every single news station that wanted to interview him and basically said, this dude is great, after 2 months ago saying this dude mm-hmm. sucks.
Mm-hmm. And I have to respect Governor Christie for that.
You have to.
For the honesty. I want to say 2 days after he was there, the day that it was about to hit, he was canceled campaign stops, having press conferences, you know, just wanting them, be prepared. If you can't evacuate. I believe that there are people in the Republican Party who are just, they're reaching. Their candidate, they know is no good, but they're not going to admit it. It's kind of like, I know the war was a lie, but we're not going to admit it. So they know that. They're not going to admit it. So they reach. They find any and everything. And sometimes I don't think they believe their own gab.
But here's the thing that. Here's the thing with that. Because you touched on, she touched on some big rope. This was a dude, Mitt Romney, who, when the Republicans were going through their primary, now for me it's striking that he is the guy who is the standard bearer for the Republican Party, because when the primaries were going on, they was hating this dude.
Yes.
And you had Newt Gingrich and Rick Santorum and Governor Perry down in Texas, who was calling him a liar. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not going to go so far as to call him a liar. I'm going to say he's telling lies. And I'm just not one who's going to be disrespectful and calling people out their name. I'll be more likely to address what you've done mm-hmm. as opposed to
your character.
Your character. I'm not gonna, I'm just not going to do that. I'm not going to attack his character. I'm going to just attack his actions.
The action.
What his actions are. These people during that period, Ruben, were saying he is telling lies. They were calling him a liar. And a lot of the things that he is saying now is different than what he was saying then. And he's switched it a couple of times. And we've heard people on the right use the phrase etch-a-sketch. You know what I mean? Like, you could say something and then you shake it up, and then it's gone. As far as Mitt Romney is concerned and what his response has been, what are your thoughts with regards to his response? Does he have a responsibility to have a response? Should he say anything? Should he do anything?
I mean, are we talking about the dude who had to pay taxes in 10 years? We talking about a dude who paid only 40% of taxes of everything he made off last year? I mean, my thing is, this is the chance. This was his chance to be like, rich people are cool. And he failed. I mean, he failed. You know, it's just one of those things where he could have been like, you know what, rich people are cool. We can help out. Yada, yada, yada. He chose not to do so. You know, it is what it is. You know, a lyricist said something years ago when the Katrina thing hit. I think everybody remembers when, you know, Kanye West went on live TV and said Bush hates black people. I'm not saying Romney hates black people. To be perfectly honest with you,
it's not about color. It's about money, though. It's class. He doesn't see color. He sees class and money, in my opinion.
Dislike Romney. I don't think he's a bad dude. I just think that he has sold himself in order to get to where he wants to be. And at this point in time, he has realized that the price is way too high.
Well, let me address the color thing. You have a lot of people who are on the right who want to disparage Barack Hussein Obama for his alleged Muslim ties, which there can be no traces to. How he has not been born in the United States, which has been proven to be incorrect. How he sat in the church of the incendiary Reverend Jeremiah Wright, who's a Christian preacher, but of course the president, Barack Hussein Obama, is Muslim. Contradiction. This is the kind of thing that they want to throw at you about President Obama. But what they don't want to talk about is the fact that Willard Mitt Romney is a Mormon. And in the Mormon church, and this is factual, 1978, May, I believe, in May of 1978, correct my month, I know my year is right, but correct my month, they just then in 1978 decided that black people were not doomed people. Black people were doomed people prior to that. If you wanted to be a black Mormon, you came into that craft solely to be a servant of a white person. And Mitt Romney was a bishop in the Mormon church. Now, I'm not calling this man a racist because it's not my place to. Because I think poor people are racist. Rich people are people who are more about their money.
If
you're a white person who don't like black people, the more money you have, the less likely you are a racist.
Right.
If you're a poor white person who don't like black people, you could potentially be a racist. But you're a rich person, you got money, and you're going to deal with somebody that's black that got money, you're going to deal with them because it's about your money than it is about the fact that he's a black dude. Let's make that point clear. But not that he's a racist or not, because I've already made that point clear. My point is, no one has ever questioned his Mormon faith the way they question President Barack Hussein Obama's Christian faith, as opposed to the potential of him being a Muslim. And even if he was a Muslim, me personally, I'm like, okay, you're a Muslim. The racism in this country is racism against Islam. Mm-hmm. And that is the reason why you got people walking around with issues with people who are Muslim, which is the reason why they are fearful of President Barack Hussein Obama. April P.
I think, if my memory serves me correctly, help me out, Marcus. During the primaries, his faith was an issue. But I think what happened, and I didn't follow the Republican primaries that closely and the debates and everything leading up to it, but I think what happened, he started kind of winning those debates, so then they stopped talking about him being Mormon. Because I know when it first started, it was like, oh, he's Mormon. I don't know if he was the first Mormon to ever run, but oh, he's Mormon, and what about his faith, and what about they do this and they can't do that? And then as he starts gaining popularity, no one is talking about the fact that he's Mormon anymore.
Right.
So
during the primaries.
So now it's just you know, like you said, it's no longer an issue.
Right.
It's just no longer an issue. We're not going to discuss that anymore.
And don't you know there's only one side really talks about religion? I mean, yeah. Last time I checked, you don't hear Democrats talking about religion. Because, I mean, they don't. The Republican Party talks about anybody's religion. They talked about Barack Obama's religion. But I don't think I've ever seen a commercial coming out saying Mitt Romney is a Mormon. And mm-hmm. we should not like him because he doesn't believe in you know, he mm-hmm. believes in making the United States China. I mean, because last time I checked, I haven't seen that.
You know, tomorrow is going to be a big day in this country. That's all I can say from that. From a political aspect, Romney is not a part of the people. He's never been a part of the people. He doesn't know what the people need, and he can't see what the people see. He's promising, like, quote unquote, like Obama did, but at least Obama is making an effort to make his promises come true. Romney tells you he has a plan. Well, I just saw something flowing on Facebook that his plan is finally online, but what good is that going to do me tomorrow when it comes to going to the polls? Do you think I'm going to waste my time to go read it now? The biggest problem I have is that the RNC and any other Republican Party and the Democrats as well, for the amount of money that they put into this campaign, they could have solved a lot of financial problems this country has had, be it Medicare, be it home health, be it something. There was a lot of money spent into this campaign. That's a lot of money wasted. That's a lot of time wasted. I am sick and tired of being called by an automated system. If you really want to show me you can give jobs or make jobs, you give that call to a person. Take away the automated system. That's where you want to show me that you care. Show me that, hey, for a couple of hours a day, I cold call somebody and make a survey call. You got people doing that. But you use an automated system to have Barbara Bush call here. Heck, she's even called the show tonight.
She called the studio
twice. She called the studio tonight. Barbara Bush called the studio.
Twice.
And, you know.
We didn't put her on the air because she was, you know, on a recording.
Right. She was on a recording. Marcus thought I was joking. I was like, that's Barbara Bush. He hung up on her real quick. But the fact of the matter is, if you got somebody who can physically do that call and make that call, then why not have them do it? You want to give it to an automated system. And that's taking money away from me. So you're not making any help or progressing the nation from that standpoint of creating a job. You took a job away from somebody. Plain and simple.
Here's the thing. When you look at the difference between the two candidates, a lot of it has to do with who you trust. Who you trust. You know, ultimately, when you go to the polls tomorrow, you know, if you're undecided, you're just undecided. I don't see how anybody can be at this point. But, you know, when you look around, you have to use your own judgment to determine who's going to be the best candidate from you. One thing that I do want to point out with regards to Willard Mitt Romney is some of the things that he is saying in Ohio, which we know is a state that is highly coveted, and no Republican has ever won the presidency without winning Ohio. So, of course, he's got a high level of incentive to win that state. In Ohio, he has made some claims about the president the GM plant there in Ohio shipping jobs to China, in large part because of the bailout and the bankruptcy and how it's going to be cheaper and things of that sort for that company to do so. But here's the problem. The president of GM said, no, not true. And the vice president of Chrysler, which is a competitor of GM, came out directly and said, that's a big fat lie. They even went so far as to say that Donald Trump, who has been a Mitt Romney mouthpiece and has been a, you know, pretty loud proponent of this Jeep to China thing. Basically, the vice president of Chrysler said that Donald Trump is full of stuff that we don't say on the air. Ain't no half stubborn markets. Malarkey.
Malarkey.
Yes, he's full of malarkey.
Yes,
yeah.
Malarkey.
So I guess my question, Abel P., I'll start with you. Apparently, this is another one of those lies. Now, there have been some fact checkers who have come out and said that China will be making Jeeps, but they're making them for the China market, just like Toyota would make, you know, the Japanese car Toyota would make Toyotas in America for Americans. So it's not quite the same.
It's not
And it's kind of, you know, shifting the facts into their own favor. Why the hell are they lying like that? I mean, I'm sitting there. I'm trying to be articulate and political. Forget all that. Why the hell are they lying?
They're reaching. That's, I mean, that's the only thing, because none of it's logical.
You got the president of their main competitor, Jeeps. Mm-hmm. You know, Jeep is owned by Chrysler.
Right.
GM has said it's not true. But, you know, Chrysler, who owns Jeep, basically said it's not true.
Right.
They're running ads on the radio. They're running ads on television. Big Roo, what's going on, man?
The average American, unfortunately, has less than a high school education. Unfortunately.
Damn, you just did you just pull a Kobe and call Americans dumb?
No, I didn't call Kobe. No, I didn't call him dumb. I'm stating a fact. It's a fact. That is a fact.
So that makes us gullible.
That makes some people who choose not to look for the actual facts makes them easier to sway.
Mm-hmm.
Now, because let's be honest, if you don't like school and you left school, why would you care to go look and see if somebody's telling you the truth?
See, that's just lazy, though.
But that's what it is. So basically, what happens is they do a whole bunch of ads and stuff saying it's this and this and whatever. And let's be honest, the only people who care about fact checks are the people who want to hear facts.
And maybe because I was a political science major and that was my field. That's what I do. But how does that make me trust you? I mean, you can't. Majority of Americans less than high school. Give me a number.
60%.
60%.
Uh huh.
So 60% of us. I'm saying us because I'm just speaking of Americans.
I'll do it easier. I'll do it 47%. I'll make it easier.
That's a big number though. 40%
That's what
we're
talking about.
Of millions in America can be blindly led. Is this the same 47% that has to vote for Obama because we feel entitled, or are you talking about a different?
No, I'm talking about the real 47%. Because let's just be honest, as far as if you look at polls,
but you don't
and stuff,
have to fact check, Ruben. I mean, if you just read a little bit, the contradictions are like right there.
If you don't have an high school education, are you going to be doing much reading?
I don't know. Are you locked up?
I mean, I understand. I understand what he's saying.
I do understand what he's saying. I'm just playing devil's advocate. I do understand what he's saying.
The thing is, April, you're giving people more credit than what they are showing that they deserve. Basically, you would think that people who live in this country who are going to vote would be smart enough to go out and pay attention to what they're doing. Just like we can give a driver's license to anybody. I saw a woman the other day. She had a cigarette in one hand and a cell phone in the other. Where the hell was the steering wheel? You know what I mean? So people don't necessarily do what they're supposed to do, Big Rule. I'm assuming that's your point.
Yeah, and on top of that, if you want to take it there, his own state's not even voting for him. Romney's own state isn't going to vote for him.
That should be the biggest like red flag, whatever. Don't vote for him.
Because
like, seriously,
when Clinton got elected, Arkansas voted for him. Arkansas is normally Republican. But they voted for their president.
Yeah, Bill Clinton.
Did Illinois carry Obama last year?
Illinois is Democrat.
Yeah, that's a Democratic state.
Yeah, I mean it's crazy. Cause I'm looking at this map thing, and as you can tell, what I'm showing everybody now,
most of the country is red.
Most of the country is red, but it's also the places where it's very rural, very
with low electoral college votes, which is the reason why it
don't
matter.
And a lot of places, a lot of people don't get high school educations. So they watch TV, and that's why they flood so many commercials on TV, is because you see a commercial enough, you're going to believe it. And if you're not smart enough, or you have the want to go and fat check, you're not going to. I'm not saying the South and Midwest are stupid. I'm just basically saying that the majority of people there don't care, and they live in a society possibly where their fathers were Republican, their grandfathers were Republican. So you have to be Republican. Free speech and free thinking is not as prevalent there as it are anywhere else.
I agree with that.
That's the thing that frustrates me, because I hear a lot of people, or I see a lot of people vote party based upon party. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I'm a Republican, so I'm only going to vote for the Republican Party.
Right.
I'm a Democrat, so I'm only going to vote for the Democrats. I don't even care what the other guys or the other lady has to say. And that part frustrates me, because you're not paying attention to the fact that the guy that you're going to vote for is not speaking the truth. Every time he speaks is a little bit different than the last time he spoke. I'm speaking to Governor Romney. And then when you look at the fact that the president has done what he says he's going to do, Big Rube, you know, has he gotten the economy where we want it? No. But for the most part, everything else he said he was going to do, he was going to do, Big Bro.
And you know what? This 47% that Romney speaks of, let's just be honest. Is he really talking about us? Because as Obama is the food stamp president, 33% of people on food stamps are Caucasian. 25% of them are African American or black. So at that point in time, you're talking, that's obviously more than 47%. So who exactly is Romney talking about?
But I feel like Romney speaks more to money and class. I honestly don't think he meant that as like black people or people in housing projects or people. Class. He's a class capitalist person.
That's what he's speaking to. The thing that he's speaking to class, true. But you got a lot of poor Republicans who are going to vote for him simply because he's the Republican nominee.
That's true.
And that's sad, because as a capitalist, I mean, I understand if you're a rich person, you're a capitalist person, voting for him, cool. But if you're a poor person, you're a poor white person who lives in rural Virginia, you know, voting for Mitt Romney may not be the best thing for you. But that goes back to what Ruben was saying, because he ain't Barack Obama or the Democrat, you know, a lot of people want to play the race card, and I understand why they do it, and I'm very likely to do that on occasion. Certainly in this case, and I think there are as many black people going to vote for him because he's black, it's going to be just as many white people who don't like Mitt Romney who are going to vote for Mitt Romney because he ain't black. You know, and I saw a video of an interviewer who interviewed a bunch of people after a Mitt Romney rally in Ohio, and most of those people couldn't tell you what the hell he just said. He had just come off the stage, and I got it on my Facebook page. Anybody wants to see it, feel free to take a look at it. But a lot of these people couldn't tell you why they were voting for Mitt Romney. You know, they would say things like, the president is a Buddhist, and he's a Muslim, and he's an atheist. Is he really an atheist? Yeah. Is he really a Buddhist? Yeah. He's all of that. I mean, seriously? He hasn't shown any leadership, really? How's he not showing any leadership? Well, he's going on an apology tour. These are things that they're saying on Fox News. They're basically repeating it, but these people can't articulate, you know, directly what their main deal is. Big Rube, I'm going to let you get the last word in the segment, then we're going to go ahead and
And the sad thing about it all is those people who are going to vote for Mitt Romney because he is Republican are those same people, number-wise, that he's talking negatively about. Because when it's all said and done, food stamps 55%, that's more than 47%, and last time I checked, is not an even split on the food stamps. So he's talking about somebody. The question is he talking about black people, or is he really talking about Caucasian people, or is he just really talking about you?
And you know, how Steppin Marcus J, we're going to leave it there. We're going to take our final break of the night. When we come back, we got our rants and we got our closings. We're going to close it out with a nice little bang. Marcus J and I'll have Steppin be back in a minute.
This is Tay, repping the Dirty Germs, and when it comes to getting real talk on sports and what's going on in the world, I tune in to Aint No Half Steppin' with Marcus J on GlobalScaleRadio.net.